Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd, and I pray that you are all having a blessed and wonderful day. As always, I've already said my prayer, so let's get right into today's devotional, which is titled Repentance. What is the will of the Father for me that I may please Him? People have been convinced that there is a special, significant purpose for them in this world, and the concept is not a baseless one. There must be a reason that each and every one of us is born, lives, and then dies. Are we all some part of a giant ecosystem living in a terrarium called Earth for the pleasure of some superior and more intelligent being? When you think about that concept, at its simplest of levels, you could easily fall into accepting the basis of that idea. But when we apply intellectual thought to the idea, it makes very little common sense. In a terrarium, the life in it, by its comparison to us, are simple forms of life and have no ability to think and act by making calculated decisions, weighing the end results, and looking at how their actions will positively or negatively affect them through reasoning. These participants striving to live make no careful or reckless decisions based on thinking. The life in a terrarium merely reacts naturally within its ability to do so, based on its surrounding conditions in an inherent effort to survive. We are not simple plant life, but humans who have been given the ability to think, consider, process, and decide at will if we will or will not do something based on whatever reason we choose. Many people believe and understand that our lives are given to us by a superior power, thus they are prone to question what their purpose for their life in this world is. This question has been asked innumerable amounts of time by many who expect an answer directly from the Creator Himself because they have not considered that He has answered this question over and over throughout the manual He has provided for us, His Word. Many people wander around in a lost and confused mind condition, crying and pleading out to the Most High to give them direction when He has already done so. People don't like putting forth effort into things like reading. Instead, they would prefer to be spoken to directly, instead of wasting time, as they view it, putting effort into reading. Studying, they realize, takes dedication, diligence, patience, and most of all, time. The justification usually comes down to an excuse like, if I read it, I'm not going to understand it anyway, so just tell me what it means. But we are mandated in 2 Timothy 2:15 to study to show thyself approved unto Yah, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word aright, or rightly dividing the word of truth. If we don't study the word of the Most High diligently, often, sincerely, and with a contrite spirit, how can we truly know what His will for us is? Yeshua says to us of understanding that, I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when He is come, which is the Spirit of truth, He will lead you into all truth. John 16:12-13. He says that we are sanctified through truth and that thy word is truth. John 17:17. If we are not in the word, how can we receive the truth? Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither know him. John 14:17. And what is the Spirit of truth? The Geneva Note says that the Holy Ghost, also called wisdom, is also called the Spirit of truth, of the effect which He works, because He inspires the truth into us, whereas otherwise He has truth in itself. Here's a bit of wisdom for all. Remember, He can be male or female. Never forget that the world cannot receive the Spirit of truth because it lives by the flesh and not by the Spirit. The Spirit of the Most High by the Word also has many names. John 15:26 says, but when that Comforter shall come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth of the Father, He shall testify of me. So to understand the will of the Most High for us, we must understand where we are to attain the knowledge we are seeking, who we are to receive it from, and what our responsibility in doing so is. Nothing good is given unto us without a sincere effort on our part being put forth to fulfill the promise or thing offered, even if it is free. Having to do something increases the sincerity on our part by displaying a real effort. We should expect that the greater the free offering or gift, the greater the effort should be that we have to put into receiving it. When no effort on our part is required except to just receive or just take what is being offered outside of maybe listening to rhetoric or signing your name, we must approach these offers with extreme caution. So it is with baptism. Many have approached this desired ceremony merely by listening to smooth words of motivation and encouragement by men, which moves them with some false euphoric feeling of wanting to give their lives to Yeshua and do what is right. But without repentance and a true understanding of it, this attempt to surrender the life to Yeshua often turns back into things all too familiar as before. Often some small changes may occur by the allowance of the enemy, just enough to give one the impression that they are that new creature. Thus, we can't talk baptism without understanding repentance first, because there are multitudes who have been baptized, if not once, but multiple times, and have ended up with the same resulting condition, a wet sinner who has not changed his character because he doesn't truly understand repentance, thus truly hasn't repented. The expectation that Yeshua is going to change us because we are baptized is a flawed understanding designed by the enemy to mislead the Most High's children to perdition. Why has my life not changed since I was baptized, one may ask? The simple answer is that going through a ceremony that represents something only symbolizes that which it represents. There is an action required outside of the participation of that ceremony if one expects to receive the desired result they are looking for. You cannot perform something symbolic in nature and expect it to be fruitful based on that act alone. Speaking of acts, as the people were convicted of their sin on the day of Pentecost, they pose a question in Acts 2:37, asking Peter, "What shall we do?" He stated two things in the order they needed to be performed. Acts 2:38 reads, "Then Peter said unto them, amend your lives, or repent, King James Version, and be baptized every one of you in the name of Yeshua for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost." In Luke 13:3, Yeshua says, "But except ye amend your lives, or repent, King James Version, ye shall all likewise perish." An important part of his will for us is that we amend our lives or repent of our sin and sinful ways. If not, we will perish. In Acts 3:19, Peter adds even more clarity to what repentance offers. He says, "Amend your lives therefore," or repent, "and turn, that your sins may be put out," or blotted away according to the King James, "when the time of the refreshing shall come from the presence of Elohim." The word keeps it simple for all to understand. We simply repent or perish, our choice. We either choose the narrow path of the Most High or the broad path which represents the world or Satan. Once again, we see that we can't serve two masters, but we will serve one. People used to know what words like repentance meant, but today many are at a loss of understanding the terminology of the word. Thus, to ensure understanding, let's explain farther. Many fail to understand the true nature of repentance. Repentance is clearly having a sorrow for sin and a turning away from it. We will not renounce sin unless we see its sinfulness. Until we turn away from it in our heart, there will be no real change in life. Many attempt to turn away from their sinful ways on their own, which for a time may be effective, but when they do this, where or who are they turning to? Are they turning to their own self-strength and their own mind? Are they turning to other men like worldly counselors, pastors, priests, therapists, or worse yet, their friends and family who are in the world? The Most High says in Psalms 146:3, "Put not your trust in princes, nor in the son of man, for there is no help in him. Why? Why? Because the majority of these are in and are of the world. So what kind of counsel will they give you? Worldly, because this is what they know. The Geneva says that we are to turn to Yeshua so that he may have the whole praise, wherein he forbids all vain confidence, showing that of nature we are more inclined to put our trust in creatures than in Yah, the Creator. By this explanation, when we turn to other men, we are raising their counsel above that of the Most High, and by proxy, worshiping them as a God superior to the Most High. No man can save us. In order to turn away from sin victoriously, we must turn to Him who is the only one who can give us the power to overcome it at an eternal level. We are not to turn to man, and this includes self, because this will only lead to a false sense of security in the world. Repentance is not merely a turning away from sin, but a turning to Him who can take away your sin. No one can do this but Yeshua. John 1:29 says, "The next day John seeth Yeshua coming unto him and saith, Behold, the Lamb of Yah, which taketh away the sin of the world." In other words, only He can blot out our sins if we truly repent and are converted. This is why Paul said that your sins may be blotted out, because they simply may not be if there is not a real conversion in the heart when it comes to sin. In these last days, time is running short for many to move on this offer of mercy by the Most High. They believe that they will still have time to change their lives when they are ready, as they continue to live in willful and ignorant disobedience to the Most High. But all must understand that the Elohim of that promise is not slack, as some men count slackness, but is patient toward us, and would have no man to perish, but would all men to come to repentance. 2 Peter 3 and verse 9. And we know for certain that He will surely come, because He has promised, and that neither sooner nor later than He has promised. He wills that all men shall be saved and come into the acknowledging of the truth. 1 Timothy 2:4. The Most High pleads with us to repent and wills that none of us should perish and be lost. Time, though, will run out eventually for most, and all must be aware that the longer it takes for us to amend our lives or repent, the harder the heart becomes against the Most High. As we stay in sin, we love it that much more and are drawn that much farther away from Him who is our only salvation. Being sorry alone for sin is not repentance. At some level, that may only be remorse. But multitudes of men and women have marched up to a podium in front of media expressing sorrow for some sin they have committed. This may be either sincere or orchestrated, but with a selfish motive attached. Many in the world do this in an effort to protect a potential loss of things like money, possessions, reputation, or job. There is rarely, if ever, any truthful acknowledgement of the Most High. It is all about self and reputation, or what the world calls damage control. Individuals make these outward reformations because they fear that their wrongdoings will bring suffering upon themselves. This is in no way repentance in the Bible sense. As with these transgressions and that of anyone who commits sin, they merely lament the suffering rather that their actions have caused and the results which may follow, as opposed to the actual sin itself. 2 Corinthians 7:10 reads, "For godly sorrow causeth repentance unto salvation, not to be repented of, but the worldly sorrow causeth death." Note this. Godly sorrow is when we are not terrified with the fear of punishment, but because we feel we have offended Yah, our most merciful Father. Contrary to this, there is another sorrow that only feareth punishment, or when a man is vexed for the loss of some worldly goods. The fruit of the first, repentance, and the fruit of the second is desperation, unless Elohim helps speedily. Repentance is about a change in our character, as well as a change in our thought process or the way we think. We must consciously decide to stop living life our way and choose to live it Yah's way. He says, "If any man love me, he will keep my word," John 14:23. "And he that loveth me not keepeth not my words," John 14:24. Lip service may serve to convince men that you are a godly individual in their sight, but it avails to nothing in the sight of the Most High, which is usually not a concern for those only out to impress men anyway, because they are generally not keeping the word of the Most High. They tend to love themselves and the gains of this world just a little more than the Most High, in spite of the fact that Yeshua said, "Thou shalt love Elohim thy Yah with all thine heart, with all thine soul, and with all thy mind." Matthew 22:37. We are to express our love to Him with every fiber of our being freely. Now that you understand repentance, are you ready? Do you have a true sorrow for sin? Do you see the sinfulness of the sins you have committed? Are you ready to give up the pleasures of the world and fight the fight of righteousness? This is Brother Lloyd, and remember, the Heavenly Father doesn't call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. Have a blessed day.